occasion, Bill comes in their branch office where the branch employees use the system every day. So I'm going to skip this part, seeing it yesterday. Standard man, green big, 50 years old, 20 countries throughout Japan using this system. It's still building up. I'm going to use it in at least 15 countries throughout the afternoon. So I was thinking on how can I explain to you why this system is so important for that. And it's a book to explain, and I need to explain it because they made a little movie about it to self-promote the system in their own organization. So I'm going to show that. Hope that it works. The sound is a bit low. So how did it start? That's interesting because we're a small house. We do nice things. We haven't got that much experience with multinational customers. So why they call us, by the way? We didn't call them, they called us. It's just a fit to your company. So I've got one had published, I think, a blog item or a paper where he described how he integrates the modeling tool and Semantic MediaWiki. And I think he used the word Iris, right? It's not a tool. So remember the presentation yesterday. And that's what triggered them. They also, but they have the process models in Iris, and they were looking for a way to get that process knowledge out of that tool. That's not so easy. So that's how they came to us. But they did it in an official way. They selected 13 suppliers, such as Microsoft, Oracle, Software AU, which is, by the way, the supplier of Iris. And they had a very strict selection criteria. Well, they ended up with us. Because we were the only ones who could build this system low cost. If you buy something from Microsoft, you're not going to have a low cost solution. So that's how they came to us, and they selected us. So, what did they really want? What was their requirements? Of course, it has a campaign business process and work instructions. But much more than that, they also wanted a complete organization structure in the system so that people could select their current role and get information which was customized for their role. If you have a large business process, you can have over 100 activities. But not all activities are relevant for every role. So then the system would filter the activities based on roles. So you get only the information that is relevant for your role. That was one of the requirements. So processes, organizational structure, also the complete products. Products that the bank offers. Products were in there, product information. And also input-output documents. Business rules applying to activities and business processes. The computer systems and applications that are supporting the business processes. Everything has to be imported from Iris, of course. If you look at the users, they have 15,000 branch office employees, and all of them will sit in 15 countries. They also estimated that at peak times there would be more than 1,000 users using the system concurrently. So one of the reasons that they have to put their faith in us, because we said, well, Semantic MediaWiki is basically the same thing in Wikipedia, and it's an easy comparison. We said, oh, Wikipedia, I'm a free user, so can we be able to do it? Content, they have more than 10,000 business projects. Don't ask me if they have 10,000 business projects among organizations, but they have it. And have them all over the country. So that there's no alternative, it has to be done from ours. Other suppliers would say, you just have to remodel your processes in our tool. Then we can stop it. But that's not an option, it's going to depend on our process models. So they also wanted collaboration functionality. Better source of knowledge if you want to improve your business process. It's the people that use that process, so actions like that. So people can comment on the process. They can share things via email, they can get notified of changes. There's a full development, testing, acceptance, production environment. So it's a full-blown information system. And last but not least, it has a single sign-on functionality integrated with the Active Directory Federation services that they use to log into the domain. This is the knowledge model, as we call it. The data structure, the ontology of the system. And the central thing here is the activity. Activity is something that you do. And if you combine activities, then you get a business process. So you can build that. So I won't explain everything. But it shows quite a complex data model. I'm an impression. I'm finally going to give a small demonstration. Harris, actually the group's difference from community school and moon, that's a new project for this visual restyle. It has all kinds of dynamic content, things like processes again here. Which processes are relevant to your role? All filters, dynamic. So, one will show you more about that. Product hierarchy. Another interesting feature about this, and I have it on the next slide, which is better to show, but to explain it here, is that the screen has two panels. The left panel is always a dynamically generated called context diagram. It displays in the middle the thing that you are looking at. So in this case, products, product group, actually retail management products. And it shows what the context is. It has parents and it has two children. And on the right hand side, it shows all the information about us. After this one, you have this, if you click another one in the context diagram, then you'll go to the same page. It's all dynamic. Process models, it's not BPMN, but it's important from Irish system and modeling standards. But it would be interesting to do it from BPMN because it's expensive. Collaboration, I'll probably show you that too. To say something about the architecture, I already said it's a full-blown information system. So we have three layers. We have the development environment, the stage environment, and the production environment, each having separate wikis. And we have wikis for each country. So there's a wiki for South Africa, for Nigeria, Ghana, Botswana, other 12 countries. They all each have their own wiki. They also have their own Irish source of business process. That's the biggest separator. The red arrows is how code is deployed. You're all familiar with that, I guess. First you deploy something in your development environment, you test it, and you go to test, or they call it staging. If everything's all right, then you can go to production. Now, we have two things here, PHP code, and we have wiki content templates. So the wiki content, that's the green arrows, that's, we're doing that separately, because we have different people, and we maintain PHP code. But the standard is not maintaining content in the wiki. So that's why we have two different screens for going from development to production. And the blue arrows are the arrows imports. So what you see there is the Irish content is not moving from they have separate databases and separate environments. So if they import in development, they will have to re-import in production. So that's the logical architecture. We also have a technical architecture. The top group, web cluster, is the web server. We have two web servers. This is the architecture. And we're still rolling out the system, so it's very likely that there will be a third and a fourth web server. On top of that, there's a load balancer. It balances the load. And in this, in the architecture, we have a shared server. But in reality, we don't have that. The servers are completely separate. They have sticky web apps. So a user that's coming into web server number one will always go back to web server one for the whole session. In the back end, we have a database cluster. Also, well, you're probably familiar with this if you're in the technical architecture behind. Maybe horizontal and scalable. So that's again a virtualized tree of balancing. We did a question about balancing always, how do you recognize if the user is going in request? How do you recognize that it's the same session as the request that you got from the session before? And what they did was they used the SSL ID, session ID. But for performance reasons, we only use SSL for logging in. After being logged in, we switch back to HTTP. Or the other page, it's all you need for a number, so why don't we need SNL for everything? So the load balancer didn't recognize that. He says, oh, you're a new user. Okay, I'll send you to this web server. And as a result of that, the web server will say, oh, it's not yet logged in, so I'll send it back to the single sign-on mechanism. So you keep on going from server to login. In the end, we switch. We use full HTTPS, and I think that's all. So, and some interesting features. As example, I explained yesterday what they can IDIS. In IDIS, every content has a UID, a unique ID, which is a number of 20 digits, which is completely useless for a human. But objects can have the same name. So we want to have a human readable name, the pages, to the same name. So what we did in the import is combine the name and the ID to create unique pages. We use semantic type of this extension to display only the human readable name. And that works fine. During the development of the system, and we still have some bugs, we sometimes saw that pages were not imported, and then you would see, instead of a link to this, with showing the human readable name, showing the full page name. So we immediately recognize, aha, that page has not been imported. So that's a very useful extension in semantic type. If you need uniqueness of pages, you can use that. I already explained that we have a lot of pages where when you go there, you're not going to have different pages, you're going to the process page. You show that process, and that's the other way around. You're not going to the process page, you're going to have different pages. But what is different depends on the process that you're coming from. So we use the process ID, we send that through a URL parameter. Based on that URL parameter, we determine what information to give this way. So we're using URL parameters to customize the page according to the content. And we also use an extension that was developed by Remco, and the dummy editor, which is going to be obsolete by students yesterday. Because we have, especially in the organization structure, we have a lot of dependencies between pages. For fast performance, we are setting redundant properties. So for a department, we will set the whole list of positions, roles, that we have in that department. And also the positions in the departments underneath that. The difficulty with that is that if the department underneath changes, then the redundant properties don't get automatically updated. So we use semantic dummy editor for that. What it does is that you configure that, say, I have this property, and any page using this property has a dependency. So when you say the page having that property, then semantic dummy editor I should call this little context diagram, we dynamically create that with droplets. We did consider importing these also from Iris, but that would mean that they don't have to make these context diagrams. So each activity, they have 100,000 items in there, so that wasn't realistic. With droplets, you can just create this, all based on semantic properties. We also replaced the standard search bar. Standard search bar is very useful, but not for this end-use situation. They have very specific requirements. Like, if you search for a process, only processes of level 4 and 5 should be displayed in the process hierarchy. Or if you search for an activity, then it should not display the activity, but it should display the processes in which these activities can appear. So we created a custom search format, just a semantic format, a query form. And we used that to replace the original search bar. I'll to show you in the demo, I think. Probably should move on. Yeah, the import was discussed yesterday. Yeah, we have two more things to do. One is that they have an old system, which is just a file server. It's an HTTP server serving word processes. And if they want to shut this down, so they ask, can you convert those word processes? We can play this.
Yeah.
Can you go right here?
Yeah.
What we did was, okay, we can do that using live logs, where you can't do anything from Microsoft Word. You can use live logs. And that was pretty good actually. You can convert a document, a Word document, to maybe we do that. That is pretty good job. So we created a script to convert all these documents, all 20,000. We did it on a test set of a few hundred documents, and it did that in like 10 minutes. So it's going to take quite some time to process all 40,000. But it will be converted to MediaWiki test. And next we have a post-processor that does some changes. Live office does them everything first. Yeah. Table, then it will put all these inline CSS styling tags. We remove them in the post-processor. We just apply one CSS class so we can afterwards determine the exact layout status. We still have to do that. The test looks good. Just a whole bunch of it's not planned yet. And another one is that we want to have the imports, it's a manual thing now, and we want to have that on a daily basis. So every night, all changes in Iris will be automatically exported to a file, and the file will be picked up by the system and imported. We also have some lessons learned. I already told you about the load balance and was messing up the sessions. Fully fine if we were looking at the logins bit, but it wasn't there, it was just an infrastructure thing. We've also done some extensive analyzing the programming, finding out where in the code we lost performance. Every code has a weak spot in performance. So we found a few spots that we can actually lose performance, depending on the type of page that per item is like 5%. Well, the master is not trying to do it. To some days, you could increase performance by 80 or 90%. So the lesson is, if you have an application built on Semantic MediaWiki, and you're not happy with the performance, try to profile. Look into it. Where in your code are you losing? Fix it. Yeah, and another one that is very difficult to solve is that we've got a lot of errors. We were doing an import, or actually last day we were doing an import. We got complaints, the system is not working, and we would investigate and say, yeah, but you made an error in Iris. If you model wrong in Iris, then the wiki is not going to call it. Garbage in, garbage out. And that's still a problem because it's very difficult. Iris is a complex environment. It's very difficult to learn, to train people to model in the right way. Okay, Juan,
How many minutes do I have?
About 7 or 8 minutes.
7 or 8 minutes. Good enough. Okay, I'm going to check the other one. This is a product tree which is dynamically created from the content we have imported. It's the base for it. It's a nice way to look at it. Okay, and this is a process page which contains all the related. You have seen the node model, and there you saw all kinds of activity processes, functional roles, application systems, etc. And this is the main page for what process, in this case, the check the raw process. And here you see the positions which all have relations with this process and also appear in this process and the system being used for it. There are no products in this case, or documents, or business rules in this case. What we see here is the actual IaaS diagram. And we also import with the data, the XML data is exported together with the pictures of the model itself. And while importing, we create image maps. So this can also be used to navigate through the data. We don't generate this picture because it's quite difficult to generate a picture in this way. Because by generation, you can't always get the nice layout. Chose to do it like this, to export pictures with the XML data, and then all the coordinations we plot on this picture as with an image map. And what was also refined is that it only click on activities, because other things are not very relevant for the only the rest of the on one of these, let's see, Snapchat, for example. And here we come in the same environment for this process on the activity page, still in the context of the process itself. And here we see the split screen, like I told. And on this side, we generate only the relations between, only the activities and their relations in between. So what you saw on the diagram with all kinds of events and XORs and all kinds of things, we filter them out. Because when you're behind the desk and you want to help a customer, then you can. You can click through this schema quite more easily because it's in the context of this activity, and then you can go to the next one. So, go to stem chat, and on the right side, you see all the process activities, and if there is data presence, there are work instructions or input output documents, etc. Click on this one, then you can see, you go to the next one, etc., and then you can also go through the model. But then, on the end of the way. What I told you, there's not too much data in this environment, so I connect to another test environment, but it's somewhat slow, that's why I don't use it here. But in most cases, it's also a very important structure, and this is what it's all about.
I think that there was a question yesterday about going to write in. okay again?
Yeah, that's okay.
It's a real demo.
So this is a very exciting about 4,000 for it. Depends on the last, how the last is the bar line. It can be quite big, by the way. We have bars of 300 to 400 megabytes and more. Because all the objects are interconnected to, for example, the system. To use SAP, there's so much relations to other objects. And it's that's a very big thing for bar, so it's quite sensitive. Yeah. Are there any questions?
Any questions?
The message is, of course, yes, you can build real, like, massive information systems based on Semantic MediaWiki.
Which before?
Yeah, but you are knocking on the door of the next bank.
Sorry?
You're knocking on the door of the next bank, because there are a lot of banks in the world.
Lots of banks use the same system, yes, yes.
And not only banks, of course.
Yeah, any organization.
Yeah.
That use ARIS.
And there are a lot of...
That use ARIS or any other modeling tool, as long as you can export some XML, whatever format, or BPMN, then we can import it. Yeah.